I think that Bitcoin by the end of this week will probably have broken all-time high, trading between 64 and about $70,000. And I can very easily see Bitcoin going to $100,000 by the end of July. We've seen a parabolic run-up over the last 4 or 5 months. And guys, a lot of that has to do with fundamentals. Like you were just saying, Ben, the stock-to-flow ratio is one of the most intrinsic reasons why Bitcoin has value in the first place. It has value because of its limited supply, and limited supply is expressed in the stock-to-flow ratio. If you want to look for any one fundamental metric about the success of any cryptocurrency project, as far as a currency, not a protocol or a platform like Ethereum or Cardano, but as far as a cryptocurrency designed to be a currency, you got to look at its stock to flow ratio. Bitcoin stock to flow ratio, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe actually passed gold during the last halving event, and it's now one of the most scarce commodities in the entire world. And for that reason alone, it is eventually going to take over government currencies. Fiat money is on its way out.
BitSwap is the hottest new way to trade tokens. Crawling all the top decentralized exchanges, BitSwap will get you the very best price and value for your trades. BitSwap is changing the game. Try it now at BitSwapDex.com.
Welcome to BitBoy Crypto, the largest crypto channel in all the interwebs. My name is Ben. Every day on this channel, I show you how to make money in cryptocurrency. If you like money and crypto, make sure to hit that subscribe button for your chance to win a full Bitcoin. Details down below. In this video, I brought on technical and fundamental expert Crypto Jebb to discuss the future of Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Cardano. All three of these coins are great, but which one has the most potential? Today, we're going to examine each one of them. Now, of course, if anything in this video gets you excited, you can trade all three of these coins we'll cover today on Bybit. Sign up for Bybit by visiting bitboycrypto.com/deals. And also, if you have problems connecting due to your IP address, we also have a deal for unlimited VPN on the deals page, which can get you around that problem. Okay, guys, let's go ahead and jump into the interview.
Ben, I am so very excited to be talking to you today. How are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'm doing very well. A lot of people know I mentioned you on the channel before. You've came on a live stream. You're definitely, you know, one of my favorite technical, you know, analysis guys. And you also weave in fundamental stuff, which I think is very rare, you know, kind of in the crypto YouTube space, to be able to meld those very well together. And you do that. So I'm excited to talk to you today and talk about my three favorite cryptos.
There we go. Thank you so much for having me on the channel. Thank you so much for coming on ours. By the way, I want to go ahead and mention something. I don't normally wear sunglasses in meetings. My glasses literally snapped in half yesterday. Can you believe that? I was just telling Ben about that. I was holding them and they just broke in half. It was really stupid.
Come on. You want to come on and wear those aviators.
Yeah, come on. You know, I kind of did. I think they look cool. But just so you know.
Well, Bitcoin is flying high, so it makes sense.
Exactly. I just got off the plane, actually, guys. We were on our way to the moon, and Bitcoin had to take a little pit stop, but it's still going there.
Yeah, I love it.
So, Ben, what do you think that is going to happen on Bitcoin over the next couple of months? Where do you think it's going to go? I'd love to hear your opinions on this, because I know that I have some opinions on where I think Bitcoin is going by the end of Friday and by the end of the month. We actually just did some price predictions on Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Cardano over on our channel this morning. So what do you think is going to happen, my friend?
Yeah, and just so everybody knows, before I get into that, I would like to say, if you're watching on my channel, you guys do make sure you go subscribe to Crypto Jeb. I'll put the put that down in the video description so people can go subscribe. Great content on there. So if you want to go check out those price predictions, you can do that. Now, in terms of Bitcoin, over the next, you know, few weeks, I have been saying for about a month now that I believe the Coinbase IPO is going to bring with it a lot of manipulation to the upside because it's beneficial for Coinbase. If you look at the valuation of Coinbase, it's directly tied to the price of Bitcoin. And so it makes sense. And if you didn't know, like, look, I'll say it again. I say it all the time. I like Coinbase. I have nothing against Coinbase. Brian Armstrong is not a relative of mine, even though we have the same last name. But I use Coinbase. I have nothing bad to say about it. But there is a bit of a crypto cartel. You know, there are a lot of people in crypto with a lot of money, and a lot of those people are tied to Coinbase. We know Coinbase was wash trading a few years ago. They just got a big fine for that. So we know it's not beneath them. Of course, now they could probably hide it a little better. I think we are going to see it's going to be beneficial for everyone, including Coinbase, if the price of Bitcoin is up the date of the IPO, which is April 14th. So I'm looking for the next couple of weeks, Bitcoin to charge actually, you know, somewhere between 70 and 80K. I think will bring a lot of hype and attention. And then beyond that, you know, certainly we might have a correction, but if you look at the stock to flow chart that puts Bitcoin at $289,000 by the end of the year in September, the thing about it is, is that it actually puts a price of 100K on Bitcoin in July. And I think it was, who was it that I just saw? I can't remember exactly who it was. I don't think it was JP Morgan, but somebody just put out a report saying that, you know, you should pay attention to that 100K mark in July. And it definitely is, you know, going to hit it at some point, probably over the summer. So I can kind of see the Coinbase IPO bringing a lot of attention, price going 70, 80K by the end of this month, then subsiding, and then over the summer going back up to 100K. And then I do believe by the end of the year, around the end of September, we're looking at a 289, my number is $322,000 Bitcoin actually, but somewhere between that range.
That's awesome. And by the way, thank you so much for the shout out. I really appreciate that, Ben. Everybody who's watching on my channel, make sure you go and subscribe to BitBoy Crypto, fastest growing, largest cryptocurrency channel in the space. My friend, I am very much in agreement with you. I think that Bitcoin by the end of this week will probably have broken all-time high, trading between 64 and about $70,000. And I can very easily see Bitcoin going to $100,000 by the end of July. We've seen a parabolic run-up over the last 4 or 5 months. And guys, a lot of that has to do with fundamentals. Like you were just saying, Ben, the stock-to-flow ratio is one of the most intrinsic reasons why Bitcoin has value in the first place. It has value because of its limited supply, and limited supply is expressed in the stock to flow ratio. If you want to look for any one fundamental metric about the success of any cryptocurrency project, as far as a currency, not a protocol or a platform like Ethereum or Cardano, but as far as a cryptocurrency designed to be a currency, you got to look at its stock to flow ratio. Bitcoin's stock to flow ratio, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe actually passed gold during the last halving event, and it's now one of the most scarce commodities in the entire world. And for that reason alone, it is eventually going to take over government currencies. Fiat money is on its way out, and you can read more about that in the Bitcoin Standard by Safedi and Amos. Ben, I actually saw on your Instagram that that's a required reading for all of your employees, isn't it? That's a great book.
Yeah. We definitely, we had some books. My favorite one's Bitcoin Billionaires, by the Winklevoss twins. I think, cause I was in crypto in the time when that book was written about, when the things that were happening in the book were happening in 2012, and seeing the history, that book has a lot of good history about Bitcoin, puts a lot of stuff into perspective, shows the Winklevoss twins were very early on knowing that at one point they said it will be bigger than Facebook, Bitcoin, bigger than Facebook. Yep. I think that though, understanding like the Andreas Antonopoulos and Safedi and Amos's book, I think those are, the internet of money. And then of course, Bitcoin Standard are good ones to read. There are other cryptocurrencies out there than just Bitcoin.
Absolutely. Oh, of course. And a lot of them are great. Like Ethereum and Cardano are two of the best decentralized application protocols. We were talking about on the stream this morning. Smay, what was it? The thing that smart contracts are being developed on over on the Binance Smart Chain? It was
The bakery swap.
Bakery swap. That's what it is. Bakery swap, and having NFTs be the fees coming down on them over on Binance. I think that's why Binance coin's been jumping lately. There's a lot of great cryptocurrencies out there.
Yeah, I think so. I think Ethereum, just set a new all-time high over the weekend. And I know there's a lot of, big stuff. There's a big conversation about, what's better, Ethereum or Cardano. I know we'll talk about Cardano in just a minute. But for me, I think this month, I said at the beginning of the month, I said, if Bitcoin goes up and Ethereum stays stagnant again, then it may be time to give up on Ethereum if you're an investor and start looking at other projects, because the institutional pull from the CME futures might be too strong. Yep. But what we've seen is we have seen the price going up of Ethereum, setting a new all-time high, not time to give up on it yet. And I want to know from your perspective, what kind of month do you think Ethereum is going to have? And what are you seeing from, both the technicals and the fundamentals when it comes to Ethereum?
So guys, the thing about Ethereum is that Ethereum has something like a 95% correlation with Bitcoin. It follows Bitcoin tooth and nail, guys. They are pretty much the same cryptocurrency when you look at their charts. However, in the last 7 days or so, something very interesting has happened. Ethereum has decoupled from Bitcoin, and Ethereum is rallying faster than Bitcoin has. Ethereum just set a new all-time high. Bitcoin actually hasn't. Even though Bitcoin is the cryptocurrency that's leading this whole bull market, the altcoins are obviously doing very well. You can see the other category on CoinMarketCap has doubled in the last 3 months. If you look at Ethereum, it's actually outpacing Bitcoin. So I think you were right on that, Ben. If Bitcoin started outperforming Ethereum and Ethereum wasn't doing very well, we'd have to ask ourselves a question. Yeah. Hey, is Ethereum really going to be able to keep up with Bitcoin? Is some of this value going to move into other projects like Binance Coin and like ADA and like Polkadot and these other great projects? Or is Ethereum going to be able to keep up? And so far, I think the short-term answer to that is yes, because we've just broken all-time high. And even today, we've rallied close back to that all-time high that we set back on Friday. So I love the Ethereum blockchain. I think it is a fantastic ecosystem. That being said, it, of course, does have its issues with high fees and low transactional throughput and its difficulty to develop on. But at the end of the day, guys, so does Bitcoin. But Bitcoin's still top dog, and it always is going to be. Bitcoin is very unlikely to be overthrown by anything, in my personal opinion, at least in the short term. So even though people might argue, okay, Cardano is a better project, yeah, but Ethereum's the top dog. Really, what I think is what it's going to come down to is a NVIDIA and AMD situation, or a Google and a Bing situation, or a Microsoft and an Apple situation. There's going to be two sharks, and one of the sharks going to say, I'm going to take a little bit of market cap over here, and the other shark's going to say, okay, I'll take mine over here, and they'll live in peace and harmony. I don't think that one's necessarily going to destroy the other one. That being said, of course, Ethereum has a lot of great updates coming out relatively soon. EIP 1559, which is controversial, but hopefully we'll be helping with that. And there's another update coming out relatively soon. I forgot what it's called, but I think Ethereum's a great project.
I think the Berlin hard fork is this month, I think. Yeah.
That's it. That's what I was trying to remember. Yeah, so as far as where I think Ethereum's going to go, guys, I really can see Ethereum going above $2,500, maybe even up to $3,000 in this month. At the end of the day, if Bitcoin rallies, Ethereum will rally. And that's really what you need to look at is, hey, if Bitcoin's doing well, Ethereum is going to do well. In fact, Ben, I think you said in one of your videos recently that Ethereum has massively outperformed Bitcoin over the last 6 to 12 months. And you're right. Yeah. It's a good project.
Well, here's the question I ask everybody, because everybody wants to point to the gas fees as holding back the price. And, you know, does that hold back, you know, NFT platforms or DeFi platforms? Yeah, I think so. But do you really believe that institutions that are putting money in Ethereum right now care about gas fees?
I think they do. And the reason is because for decentralized finance and for NFTs and all the other decentralized application protocols being built on Ethereum to become successful, they need to be scalable. And this is an issue that Bitcoin runs into. Bitcoin's low transactional throughput and slow block time does factually inhibit its ability to be adopted as a world currency. That being said, layer two solutions like Lightning Network are coming online. There's other things that are coming out that are going to help with that problem on Bitcoin. If I didn't see a solution in sight for the problems that Ethereum has, then yes, it would be a huge problem. But that being said, there are improvements on the horizon for Ethereum. The question now comes down to, are those improvements, such as EIP 1559 in Berlin and all these different Ethereum 2.0, hopefully will launch at some point. Yeah. Whenever these updates come out and they make Ethereum much more able to be used for the purpose it was created, then I don't think it's going to be a problem. Until we see that, though, we do need to keep in mind that there are some hindrances that are stopping Ethereum from reaching its full potential in what it set out to do. So that's not to say that Ethereum is a bad project, but it is to say, to be an informed investor in that project, you need to understand the fundamentals. Again, you never want to invest in anything you don't fully understand.
Yeah. Well, I would argue that they don't care about gas fees. And here's why. I would say that we're seeing, what's really interesting with Bitcoin is we've seen it go from being a currency to being digital gold. Everybody pretty much knows that.
Yep.
When it comes to Ethereum, we're seeing this really weird fork, right? Where we're seeing the use case and utility of a decentralized platform as one fork. Mm-hmm. But we're also seeing another fork develop that I believe is an alternative to Bitcoin as a store of value. And I think from the store of value side, where institutions are looking, saying, oh, we kind of missed out on getting enough Bitcoin, let's add Ethereum. I don't think they're looking at gas fees. And I think when you look at the Bank of America report, where they just said, like, the number one, you know, a couple weeks ago, the number one value of Bitcoin is that it goes up, and they're not scared of it, but they are scared of DeFi.
Yeah.
There wasn't a lot of talk about gas fees in there. And I think that really sometimes I think we give institutions too much credit. I think we are people that are in cryptocurrency. I think we know more in our little finger about Ethereum and cryptocurrency than even the best researchers they have at these banks.
Yeah.
Because they're just, it's like an old guy on Facebook. You know, when it comes, you just see it with what they say. It just sounds so, you know, basic level. Well, we talked about Cardano a little bit, or we talked about Ethereum. I want to move on and talk about Cardano for just a couple minutes here, because you recently had done a video the day before the Coinbase announcement. Saying,
I know.
A great timing on that.
I know, right? Come on now.
Yeah, I was like, oh man, I want to talk to Jeff about that 70 cent Cardano prediction.
Yeah.
And then literally within, I think it was like 6 hours, you posted that video, the Coinbase news came out.
No, I made the video at like 10 o'clock in the morning, and then the news came out at 3. I'm like, come on. If, for those of you who don't know, I was talking about in that video that it is possible if Cardano does not see more bullish momentum come into it, which, by the way, Cardano's trading sideways right now still. Mm-hmm. It still is the same problem that I was pointing out in that video. I was saying that it may drop that low if the bulls continue to fall over and not be able to maintain the market. That being said, what I tell people on our channel all the time is the technical analysis is very useful right up until the fundamentals overrule it, because the technicals could not have in any way predicted that. At the end of the day, Coinbase listing Cardano is the largest adoption story that Cardano has perhaps ever had. And I applaud the Cardano project for that. In fact, I'm actually getting some people involved in Cardano pretty soon and trying to get them invested in it. I think it's a great project.
Yeah. So, yeah, I love Cardano. I think it's, you know, I say I'm in a weird threesome with Cardano and Ethereum. And, you know, their communities, like, you know, whichever one I talk about that day, they love me. And if I, the other one hates me, but
I get that. Yep.
Because I believe you're right when you say that this is like, you know, Apple versus Android kind of, you know, or Apple versus Microsoft, you know, at earlier times. I think Cardano and Ethereum are going to be around for a long time. I think Polkadot factors in somewhere, but I really personally believe more in Ethereum and Cardano. But, you know, I think that Polkadot has a place. I think Elrond has a place. I think Solana has a place. But I think we're looking at the two giants here, and I think they're going to remain that way. We're seeing now, like, some institutions are looking at Cardano. And I think there's a reason for that. They understand the long-term play, the slow roadmap. I, you know, definitely saw that video at 70 cents that you said it could go down to and was like, that's a little sketch. Like, that may be too low. I understand the technicals are saying that, but there's a lot of bullish stuff going on. But overall, what is your prospects? What do you think we're going to see for Cardano in the next, let's say, few months? You think we're going to see continuing sideways action? Because I could see that depending on how high the market goes.
Yeah, so it really depends on what the rest of the cryptocurrency market does, because you can look at the whole cryptocurrency market as one massive index fund that all moves together. Really, a lot of these cryptocurrencies have very high correlation. So whenever Bitcoin rallies, the altcoins are naturally going to follow. And in fact, the altcoins are outpacing Bitcoin right now. That's something you've been talking about on your channel, how the altcoins, that if you look on the other category in market dominance on CoinMarketCap's dominance chart, you can see it's doubled from 8% to 17% in the last 3 months. That's because small cap altcoins are starting to gobble up a lot of the attention as more money is flowing into them. That being said, one of the reasons that I love Cardano, and this will lead me back to the question, one of the reasons I love Cardano is that unlike Ethereum, it actually has a maximum supply of 45 million coins. Ethereum does not at the moment have a maximum supply, which means that it is subject to continual inflation, unlike Bitcoin, and in this case, unlike Cardano. So while both of them do something similar, as far as an investment in the coin, which is reflective of the blockchain, but the coin itself has to be able to maintain value over time, I love the investment of Cardano because unlike Ethereum, it actually has a limited supply. And they've talked about this in all kinds of developer conferences and everything. Cardano is a good investment, not just because of its protocol, but it's also a good investment because of the coin itself. Remember, when you're investing in the Ethereum coin, you're investing in the Ethereum coin and then the blockchain.
Yeah.
Well, the blockchain might do very well, but what if the coin doesn't? Because overnight, the supply doubles for whatever fundamental reason or for whatever developmental reason. So as far as where I think it's going to go, in that video, I was talking about a 70-cent correction, but I was still very bullish on in the long term. I think Cardano is going to do exceptionally well in the long term, especially as it's coming out of that price discovery phase that happened in quarter four of last year. It's rallied up to $1.48. And I think based on all the fundamentals that you and I are talking about here, it's going to go much higher. I think in the next 2 years, it could go between $5 and $15. In fact, in the next couple of months, I think it's going to go to more like $2 or $3.
Wow.
I think it's going to be very bullish. I don't actually know what your prediction is on it, though, Ben. What do you think?
$8. Make a holla.
You think it's going to $8? When do you think it's going to $8?
Well, by the end of this bull run. I mean, I think Halloween is the end of, by the end of the altcoin cycle, I think it'll be around Halloween. I can see Cardano reaching 8. I can see a lot of people wanting it to get to 10. And I think between 8 and 9, people will start taking profits, and that could kind of be the end. So
that makes sense to me.
It's already had a massive run up. I mean, it was down to 2 cents at one point. So I think everybody sees the prospects on it are really great. But overall, bullish on Bitcoin, bullish on Ethereum, bullish on Cardano.
Amen. Great projects, guys. If you're looking for anything to invest in, those three are ones that you can't really go wrong with.
Yep, absolutely. I agree 100%. And I think that, you know, this has been a great collaboration here.
Yeah.
Look forward to having you on the channel again in the future. And I think for today, that's going to wrap it up.
Good deal. Thank you so much for joining me, Ben. Thank you so much for having me. Guys, if you haven't already, from my channel, make sure to go and subscribe to Ben. Go smash the like button and go spam his comments saying that Jeb sent you. I'm sure he will let it slide for one video. We got all kinds of spam in the comments, don't we? I hear you're working on something for that.
We are. We got something up our sleeve is what I'll
say. I'm looking forward to hearing what you got to say about that. Ben, do you want to wrap us out?
Yeah. I just think, guys, it's a great time to be in cryptocurrency. Yep. Jeb, you know, thanks as always for coming on the channel. Guys, to everybody in the community, make sure drop some comments down below. Let us know what you want us to talk about next time, what kind of coins you want to see. And that's all I got. Everybody be blessed.
Be blessed, guys.